just going back to the rivalry between BDP and Shan and Juice Crew at large, really, and BDP and Mo D and LL and Roxanne and UTFO and even Red Alert and Magic. All you guys, all these legends had pretty fierce rivalries back in the day, but it pretty much stayed on wax, and now everyone is respectful of everybody else when we're talking about these times and these records. And nowadays, it's a lot different. You know, sometimes these rivalries spill off wax. Sometimes they don't even make it onto wax before there's violence and just foolishness. What do you think has changed?
Well, there's more money at stake, and believe it or not, and let me not breeze over that real quick before I say the next point. Money makes people violent. I'm sure I say the loss of money makes people violent. Once you've tasted the sweet savor of a cool 50 grand in your pocket, and then somebody says some off-the-wall craziness that depletes that 50 down to about $20, you ready to fight. You ready to fight. And this thing happens in a split second. Why do people retaliate based on what is said or heard? Well, because it's damaging your status. And in hip-hop, your status is connected directly to your money. No one comes to see you just because you have a great song. Those days were over for hip-hop when hip-hop even began. Only legendary super groups like Run-DMC, these kinds of groups, Fat Boys, Houdini, even LL to an extent, but not really. But these other groups were able to do songs that you came to see them perform the song. For the rest of us, coming up in hip-hop in the mid-80s, we had to prove to each other that we were worthy of representing the entire hood. Because the one that represents the whole hood is the one that the hood pays. That's the one that the hood comes out to see. That's the one that, you know, gets respect even, you know, just on another level, gets respect. So that fight to be recognized as an important and relevant figure in the hood, connecting directly to your money, causes people to fight. Back in the days, our beefs were just as frequent as today's beefs, and it's ironic that you're talking to KRS-One. And seems to have a checkered cast in this particular arena. But the issue, what we had then that we don't seem to have today, was we had a governing council on hip-hop. Hip-hop operated with certain rules, certain laws, principles. These laws and principles were set down by, first by Kool Herc, then Afrika Bambaataa, then Grandmaster Flash. And they were different kinds of rules. Herc brought fun, and the fact that the what we call the core four elements, breaking, MCing, graffiti art, DJing, with beatboxing as that fifth element, Dougie Fresh coming in with Biz and others. These are the things that kept us together. To play this game, you had to play within the circle of this particular game. And so you was a B-boy, B-girl, an MC, graffiti writer, or DJ. And within those terms, you had principles. You didn't, you know, certain things. You don't talk about nobody's mother. You don't, you know, when you get to the top, you bring your crew with you. You never forget where you came from, wherever you are, you shout your neighborhood. These things are specific to hip-hop, you know. Mm-hmm. Jazz artists and rock artists and gospel, they never did that. I mean, every once in a while somebody say, well, where you from? Well, I'm from New Orleans, you know. But never you get on stage and you hear, you know, somebody say, yo, what's up, to, you know, some hood somewhere, you know. And you know, that's unique to hip hop, but this is all connected to your cash. And this is what was beautiful about hip hop, in the sense that we created our own reality. We created a reality where our own people judged who was going to rise amongst us, and you had to have talent, and you had to prove that talent against other talented people. And this was the foundation of hip-hop itself, coming off of Africa Bambaataa, by the way, who was the one who said in the 70s to all the gangs, all the major gangs in New York, he said, we got to end the whole gang culture in New York and become MCs, DJs, graffiti writers, beatboxers. Like, and this is a brilliant, somebody's probably going to write a book about it in the future, maybe, this as well. But that Africa Bambaataa, going, you know, starting off as Kevin Donovan, the leader of the Black Spades gang in the 70s, the biggest gang, most notorious in New York. He leaves and goes to Africa, gets an epiphany from a Zulu chief, comes back, Africa Bambaataa, and tells all the gangs in New York, put down the guns, the knives, and the constant fighting, and let's become MCs, DJs. Let's do what Kool Herc is doing, basically, is what he said to them. And everybody said, okay. And all the gangs, like, imagine, that gang culture was over in, like, one summer in New York. Just nobody wanted to be part of that anymore. And you had gangs, you know, just dissipating, but also the offshoots of these groups becoming the Treacherous Three, the Furious Five, the Romantic Fantastic, you know, even the Cold Crush. You know, Grandmaster Caz was part of a group called the Casanovas. You know, when gang culture flipped, he became Casanova Fly. He kept his gang moniker, his name, he kept that. But now he's Grandmaster Caz now. Now he's talking about, you know, he's rhyming. And this is all Africa Bambaataa. This is his genius. His impact on New York in the late 70s or early 80s. And so from that, we had that to go by. We was able to, yo, you know, we're not stepping outside of true hip-hop, which originates from this root, from Kool Herc in the Bronx to Africa Bambaataa to Flash, even Russell Simmons and the whole Def Jam, Sugar Hill Records was just before that. But we said, you know, we had rules. We had, you know, we had a story that we all knew, and we all stayed with our story. So by the time we get to battling, you know, you would start it off with Kumo D and Busy B. By the time we get to Kumo D and Busy B, it could never arrive, you know, fist fighting and shooting at each other. And it could never be that. Busy B was Zulu Nation, straight up. And Kumo D was as well. Both respected BAM. So they're not going to go off on the deep end, because on another level, the crowd is going to say, nah, you're not real hip hop. Why? Because you talked about his moms. Ah, okay. So, you know, you're not real hip hop. Why? Well, because, you know, you got angry and punched him in his face after, you know, the battle. The crowd would diss you in that sense, and you wouldn't, you know, it would affect your pocket. So, we had that to go by. Today, there's no story. There's no coherent story. It still is for those MCs, DJs, writers that want to associate themselves with the story and say, yes, there's a story, a line to hip-hop, that if you want to discipline yourself and be part of that, what that lineage of hip-hop, you too can gain the respect of those who are part of that. And that lineage now is deep, because you're talking about people now that are 50, 60, almost 70 years old. You're talking, this is not, you know, 14, 15, 16 years old. We're talking about police chiefs, heads of state even. You know, I was talking to somebody today about the fact that President Putin in Russia may actually know who DMX is. And we were just talking about the craziness of that. Like, you know, here's, you know, hip-hop is so... It's beyond mainstream. It's not. It's like it's folklore now. It's like you cannot discuss America without discussing hip hop's history. Even, you know, you're kind of missing something. You know, if like the president, President Obama was making a joke about Tupac and Biggie, and a couple of years ago. At a presidential roast, you know, he's telling jokes to this. You know, he's the president. He's telling jokes. He says, you know, something pertaining to allocating funds from the FBI to go look for Tupac and Biggie, and everyone laughed in the room. And it was funny because it's like, well, first of all, this is the president, and this is like military people. This is politicians. This is other business people. They all know Tupac and Biggie. You know, they're so much so that the president can make a joke at this elaborate dinner about searching for Tupac and Biggie, and everyone laughs. But yet we treat hip hop as if it's just it's just some cool music. And what happened to old school hip hop? I just want to hear some old school right now. I don't like what's playing on the radio today. What a terrible loss! Like, what a loss! We lost the story. The story's gone. You know. So yeah, let me just put a period there. I guess I'm way past the question.
Yeah, I mean that kind of lines up the next question. We could probably make this the last one if you want. About the story and putting hip hop in front of politicians and how. Politicians are now familiar with it and they know the figures in hip hop and they know some of the music. How did that work for you or against you when you tried to, you know, and brought the temple of hip hop in front of the United Nations? Was that a difficult task?
Well, actually, it was the opposite. The politicians and the church leaders and the UN itself, Kofi Annan, UN press secretary's office, well, he's the secretary general at the time, but also the UN press secretary, UNESCO, UNICEF, they were all supportive. All were supportive. All of them were part of the event itself. In fact, we were hosted by UNESCO, and it was important to be hosted by UNESCO because their acronym is the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, and we wanted them to host us because we were declaring hip-hop an international culture, a world culture, like you would say Greek, Italian, Zulu, you know, whatever, you would say hip-hop. And we brought that before the United Nations and was accepted, by the way. And we put a document called the Hip-Hop Declaration of Peace before the United Nations. It was signed by all the founders of hip-hop, including the members of UNESCO and other NGOs and people that were there as well. The biggest challenge was hip-hop itself. Believe it or not, everyone was terrified. It was an extreme act for its day. The event took place May 16th, 2001, and it was an extreme act. It was from, if you count backwards, from 2001, you know, go back to 2000, 99, 98, 99, go all the way back to basically 89, go back to 89 with the Stop the Violence movement.
Right.
And when we did Self-Destruction, from the song Self-Destruction is when we started talking about hip-hop as a culture, as a community, as a specific thing in the world. We had united, we had formed a united body. And again, that was another reason, just on the last question, another reason why what this generation today of hip-hop, this hip-hop generation today doesn't really have as well, or might not even be capable of because of just the largeness of it. But there was a governing body. And so the people from the Stop the Violence movement, all the artists, as well as the behind-the-scenes people, this is when we started having conferences and summits and symposiums, and we started to discuss hip-hop as its own thing and how to preserve it and this kind of thing. So we had about a good 50 to 100 summits from about 89 to right up to the UN. And everyone joined in. Of course, you know, the Stop the Violence movement, we were among the first. Really, Zulu Nation, again, Afrika Bambaataa, was the first, because he used to have these meetings, Zulu meetings, up in Bronx River from as early back as like 1980. And we would discuss hip hop there, but Bam was discussing hip hop more as a philosophy. There were lessons to learn, and peace, love, unity, and having fun, and the infinity lessons, and all of this type of stuff. It was more of a teaching kind of thing, the way Bam approached it. But then from out of that, we formed the Stop the Violence movement, which Bam was, Afrika Bambaataa was part of as well, and really helped to influence it as well, because there was a very famous meeting that happened just before the Stop the Violence movement, which happened in 87 at Latin Quarters, where Afrika Bambaataa basically called for a certain movement like that. 2 years later, we would be able to do it with a woman named Ann Carley, who was the head of Jive Records. She called for the Stop the Violence movement based on the song that I had done called Stop the Violence.
Right.
And so from there, all of the talk, what we got to do for hip-hop, how are we going to preserve it, how we, you know, what hip-hop means to our children and to the public. What does hip-hop mean in 10, 20 years from now? We started to discuss that there. Those discussions and all of those summits came to the point at May 16, 2001, where we finally stopped talking and came to a census where we said, these are, I had asked everybody for principles. You know, what are the principles that we can live by for hip-hop longevity, to have longevity in hip-hop? What are the principles? Just one sentence or paragraph, you know, and I asked about 60 people. And I got about 32 paragraphs from people, everybody from Bam, Herb, Flash, Russell, Kaz, everybody just put in something. And I gave those principles to the Tats crew. And the Tats crew wrote up a whole piece, documented a thing which they didn't finish. They weren't able to finish it, but they brought the unfinished document to the United Nations, and everyone signed the unfinished document. When the document was finished, we made posters of it and gave out about 20,000 of them over a 3 or 4 year period. But the hardest thing was the people themselves. Grandmaster Flash left. He was scheduled to speak, and he left. He was just too nervous. Harry Allen was nervous, but he went up and he swallowed his nervousness and went up and said something. Popmaster Fables, who was representing Zulu Nation, he too was nervous. Me and him had to go over his speech several times before he was satisfied with it. And there was others that was in the place that couldn't believe that we was in the United Nations discussing hip-hop before world leaders. And we were. And it was a great event. We served food. It was wonderful. And we declared hip-hop an international culture of peace and prosperity. So, you know, somewhere in the United Nations, we're on the books as being a world culture. The only issue now is that hip-hoppers have to believe themselves that they are a world culture. The same thing happened with the United States Constitution, where when the Constitution in 1789, I think it was, when they finally put that document together, it took about 5-6 years, some say up to 12 years, for all of the people of the colonies to even know that a constitution even existed. You know, once a few people put something together, then your whole nation has to know that this this is what has happened. But also there's the backlash of it as well. Right after that, people felt that I was trying to create laws for hip-hop, like to put everyone under what I believe hip-hop should be. That was a major concern amongst a few people. And there was that. There was also the cult part of it, because the Temple of Hip-Hop was the lead organization, obviously putting it together, and people felt that at the time KRS-One is starting a cult. The KRS is starting a new religion, and we're all going to praise Chris under the sun. And so there was that, and I'm laughing today, but these are serious concerns in 2001, and I didn't help any, because in my mind, hip-hop is a religion already, and that's what also prompted me to write the Gospel of Hip-Hop as well, to go ahead and just take it right there, and let's just think this thing completely out. But I also think of hip-hop as a nation, as a new civilization. I put it in all my music when I can, and I speak about it on college lectures, that we're not just a music genre, a rebellious music genre. With that, you know, with some good music, no doubt. But hip-hop, if you look at, if you put hip-hop against the history of theology or the history, well, not even theology, just the history of Christianity, the history of Buddhism, the history of Islam, the history of Hinduism, the history of Judaism, the history of any of the major religions, hip-hop parallels this completely. The history of the United States, the history of many of the countries in Europe, many African countries, hip-hop mirrors the birth of these major countries. But if the people of hip-hop don't believe unto themselves that they have the right to be a new nation, that they can, we can establish ourselves as a specific sect of people and say, hey, this is how we're going to conduct ourselves, and here's how we're going to take care of ourselves, and we are called hip-hop, and this is it. Here's our traditions, here's our history, here's what we're about, and this is what it is. Well, now you've changed the world. And I believe that this is the next level of the civil rights movement, which is what I call civilization rights, to go from civil rights to civilization rights, which is basically the sovereignty that slavery and colonization and imperialism took from our forefathers, and foremothers, our ancestors. If we are for those of us that have a connection to their ancestors, whether it's, you know, spiritually or directly, the continued struggle for sovereignty, to regain our freedom, not a freedom that's given to us through law, not liberty, but real freedom. And that freedom comes from sovereignty, being a sovereign nation unto yourself. And that's not just somebody, no one can give you sovereignty, but people can acknowledge your sovereignty and not invade your space. Or if they are in your space, they follow your laws, they follow your traditions, they dress like you dress, they try to speak the way you speak. They don't invade your space with their ways. That's called imperialism. You're just going to come in my space and I'm supposed to act like you, think like you, talk like you, dress like you, but I'm not you. You know, that's oppression, colonialism, that kind of thing. If we really have gotten past those what was called dark periods in American history, you know, they say slavery is a dark period, early colonialism, a dark period, imperialism and the invasions of U.S. on Mexican lands and trying to take Canada as well and all of that. Oh, those are just dark periods in American history. If those were all dark periods in American history, then let's move past it then. We all agreed it was wrong. Let's move past it. And how do we move past it? In the idea of slavery and colonialism, restore our sovereignty. And sovereignty basically meaning we have the right to govern ourselves. Let's begin to govern ourselves. It's not just that the American government is not going to shoot at us or arrest us or whatever. It's more the fact that can we internally get along with each other? Can we internally take care of one another? We need a farm. We got to grow our own food. We need a pond so we can grow fish and eat them. Or whatever you need. You know, we need to take care of ourselves. We have to import our oil or come up with solar power. We have to, you know, make our own clothing. We have to have something to trade to the world, you know, this kind of thing. Can we live as hip-hoppers, sovereign, on our own, educating our children, and they grow up to be great people? You know, we're Italians and Greeks, just as examples. They're saying, wow, look at hip-hop's children. They're great. They invented this. They cured that. They built that. You know, African cultures and Asian cultures are looking upon us, Native American cultures looking upon us, saying, wow, look at hip-hop's children. They bring them the light everywhere they go. They make things better. Wow, look at where they came from. Look at their ancestry. Started on the crack block, selling, going to jail by the dozens. Now look at them. These guys are on their way to the moon. They invented a whole new thing called time travel. You know, the aliens we've been looking at is really hip-hoppers that invented time travel and illusion. Ah, whatever it is. But at the end of the day, can you think on this level? Can you see yourself in a new city called Hip-Hopia, for lack of a better term, and you're governing your own city, a city without police, to bring it back to your first question even? Can we live amongst each other with no police officers? In other words, no crime. No reason for hostility and aggression against your neighbor. There's no reason for it. I would love to work on a project like that to form a city, a new city. First of all, that would bring jobs to the United States if the federal government just said, yo, we're going to build a new city. Let's go. That would solve immigration. It would solve jobs. That would solve everything, because everybody would be part of that and do that. But it'd be a new hip hop city, and why not? I mean, can we think on that level? Developers today grew up on Public Enemy. They could see it. Architects and developers, engineers, people, you know, they could see it. But, you know, these things take time. So this was the point to the United Nations, the gathering we had there on May 16, 2001. Because we had that gathering, we are now able to move on to other areas of hip-hop's existence, like declaring it an international culture of peace and prosperity, or giving our children a history that when you look back into hip-hop, sure, you could go to MTV and see chicks on a pole, you could see dudes drunk, holding the gat, selling the crack on the corner, you could see dances, you could see fashion, you could see, and they're going to see all that. Imagine people from in the year, say, 2070. You know, they're going to look back on their hip-hop history. They're going to see everything MTV put out, everything DET put out, everything. And not even the internet, because the internet, I'm noticing, doesn't even capture a lot of the past stuff. The internet goes back a little bit, some classic stuff. But I noticed that like YouTube and stuff like that, they don't keep the old stuff. I guess their servers or whatever it is, they can't hold all the old stuff. So it's like, if you're going back, like, say, you know, 70, 80 years from 100 years from now, somebody's using the internet to go back on their history, they're only going to be, unless something changes, they're only going to be able to go back about 50 years, 60 years. In that way. And now they got this new thing called ancestry.com, where you're actually being told what your history is. You know, you got to trust. That's a major trust. Ancestry.com, where you could actually, you know, look up your history through health records and so on, and be told now, this is who you were, this is who you are, this is what it is, so on and so on. The future's going to look really crazy. The very history that we're living in right now will not exist. Or it will exist if a group of people who feel it should exist make it exist. And that is the hard work, or the disciplined or principled work of a hip-hop historian, of someone like myself. I bear many titles, hats, hip-hop philosopher, historian, whatever, in that sense. Those of us that think about hip-hop in this way, the preservation of it, the growth of it, making it viable for people to be able to eat from it today, even, and in the future, making it valuable. These are the things to think about. Never think about today. You know, I love Eckhart Tolle and his book, The Power of Now. But we roll by a principle called the power of future. And in the power of future, it is the fact that, you know, today was, you know, this was my future. Today, this now, was my future. And the calendar, when you look at the calendar, those empty boxes in the calendar is your actual future. It's your actual future. That you can write anything in those empty boxes and begin to maneuver yourself toward that. And it will come to pass. The calendar was one of the most magical documents ever created. The calendar, to be able to map time on a piece of paper, and according to the spiral of the earth, according to the spinning of the earth, you can actually create your future. You can be in a Monday and say what you're going to do on a Friday, and then do it, even prepare for it. Well, the same happens with generations as well, that your generation is the Monday of another generation's Friday.
Right.
And when you understand your position in time like that, then you rise to that level where you say, which is why we knew it was so important to do the United Nations and other symposiums we had. I thought the one at Boston College, the one at Boston College, was phenomenal. Years before that, 1998, it was at Boston College, me and Herc and Grandmaster Flash and Cope 2. Graffiti writer and AD from the Cold Crush. It was one of the first times all of us were together talking about hip-hop. But these symposiums, these things, these conferences we do, they interfere with history. And this is the point, that history is not read, it's lived. And so when you understand, yo, I am hip-hop, I am making the history of hip-hop with my very life, my actions in life create hip-hop, then you start acting different. You start deliberately doing some things and disciplining yourself against other things. And just to answer the other question, the one just before this, this is what this generation doesn't have today. And it's not that it doesn't have, like, it doesn't want it, but, like, the technology today is such that everybody is in their own island. Everyone, you know, everybody's their own radio station. Everybody's their own TV station. Everybody's their own, you know, there are no real highs and lows. There's nobody you can go to that can actually offer you something.
Right.
You know, because you can get everything that can be offered. So there's no human communication. And so without human communication, you are now trapped in the box of technology. And, you know, we always say think outside of the box. But how can you think outside of the box when everything is a box? The computer screen is a box. The computer's a box. The tablet's a box. The TV is a box. What's that? The calendar is a box. My wife just mentioned it. The very calendar that I was just mentioning as being one of the greatest tools of all time.
It's a box.
It, too, is a box. And how can you think outside the box when the mirror is the box? Everything is a box. Oh, this is just an interesting, you know, whatever. I'm going off into something else. But yeah, man, great questions.
I appreciate it. For the people who are latecomers to the show, who missed the beginning of the interview, you're coming to Tallahassee this Sunday. What can
yep.
we expect on the KRS show at the sidebar?
September 6th is glowing on your calendar right now because, first of all, I'm extremely excited to be there. It's not every day that I get a chance to come to Tallahassee, Florida. Mm-hmm. And blaze out. I really enjoy coming to places where, you know, again, I have a specific audience. And those that come out to see KRS are looking for a specific thing as well. I predict that they're looking for a specific thing. They don't expect me to get on stage and say, now watch me, Nay Nay. Now watch me. You know, they don't necessarily expect that.
I would hope not.
You know, which, by the way, is a dope song, by the way. That's why I mentioned it. I kind of like that record. But anyway, they don't expect KRS. To jump up on that. And this is my point, is that you do come for a specific thing. Straight freestyles, punchline rhymes, the classics, of course. I'm starting from 86, obviously. South Bronx, Bridges Over, Criminal Minded. Bringing it right through the premiere era. Return of the Boom Bap, mid-90s. 90s Boom Bap. Bringing it right around to the beginning of 2000. When this is really where more of the conscious, the spiritual conscious stuff was going on right at the beginning of the year. Then I take you to a higher level with songs. I don't want to give it all away. I got news material as well off the new album, Now Hear This. We'll be flashing some of that new material as well. And of course, the open mic. Based on what the crowd is like, usually, you know, MCs should come prepared for that open mic. Sometimes I open the mic. It's not all the time that I do it, but when it's possible, we do that open mic real quick so that we all can get a taste of raw hip-hop as it goes down. So, yeah, man, I'm looking forward to this crazy. This is it, because I know the type of person that is coming to see KRS-One. You're thirsty, and you need something fulfilling to drink for the rest of the year. You need something that's going to hold you until someone like Tribe or De La or Naughty by Nature or, you know, somebody like that comes through again. This is the root that KRS comes from, that BDP comes from. This is the root. You know, and so, yeah, this is what it's going to be. I'm just thinking about it right now. I may start off with a crazy freestyle for like 10 minutes, just talking about the crowd, talking about them, to them, you know, with them.
We are looking forward to it so much. I can't even tell you, man. The hype around this show is crazy here right now.
This is the place is called the Sidebar, right?
Yeah.
Right? Sidebar. Yeah, and it's funny because, you know, the bar, the sidebar, the 16 bar, the whole thing. I mean, it's going to be pretty savage up in there. So I'm geared up and ready to go. And, of course, you know, this is not going to be a 15-minute show. You know, we have classics to do. And so, you know, come prepared. This is what it is. Doors at 8 o'clock. I'll probably be on stage about 10, 11. Let's get it popping.